Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2022. And I apologise for our slightly late start this morning. Item one is the consideration of continuing petitions. And the first item we are considering is petition number 1900. This is a very important petition on which we have heard evidence and considered previously on access to prescribed medication for detainees in police custody. It's lodged by Kevin John Lawson and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that all detainees in police custody can access their prescribed medication, including methadone, in line with existing relevant operational procedures and guidance. Now, we're joined this morning by David Strang. Good morning to Mr. Strang, the former chair of the Scottish Drugs Task Force. And joining us also is Carol Hunter, a former member of the Scottish Drugs Task Force. Carol is joining us remotely, and a very warm welcome to you, Carol, and indeed to you both. And we are grateful for you taking the time, even though you have been decommissioned, so to speak, to discuss this petition with us. As we're aware, obviously, that the task force is no longer operational. Now, members have a number of questions they would like to explore. So we can move to the first question. And if you can indicate, and I recognise, obviously, having moved on, you know, you have produced a report, and we are very keen to actually understand, in response to our questions, where you think that report can assist us. So I don't know who, have you a preference as to who will take the, will answer in turn? Or I'll ask each question. You can give me an indication, David, whether you're going to lead or whether you're going to invite Carol to take the flack. We'll see how it
Carol's
proceeds.
Happy with that.
So the first question is really during your time on the task force, what were the key concerns raised regarding the experience of people who use drugs and their current interactions with the justice system?
Well, let me begin with that. Thank you for inviting me to appear before you. And while you're right that I chaired the Drug Desk Task Force for the first 6 months of this year from January to July, I'm also now chair of the National Mission Oversight Group, which is a group that's looking at overseeing the implementation of the recommendations. Well, if I may kick off and then invite Carol to comment. The main thrust of our report is to say that substance dependency should be treated as a health issue and not as a justice issue, as a crime issue in itself. And fundamentally, we received evidence that people who use drugs often got a second-class treatment from some health and care services, but particularly when they were within the justice system, they tended to be treated as, if you like, a lesser citizen, someone who was not deserving of top-quality health care. And what we are saying in our report is that everyone in the health, in the justice system, passing through the prison courts, police station, prison, and courts, is a citizen and has a right to good health care. We know that lots of people who engage with the criminal justice system have poor mental health. Lots have addictions and substance issues, and and often they don't get well treated within the when they're in the health system, in the justice system. And we make recommendations that at every point where someone has contact with someone in the justice system, whether it's police or the courts or prison, that that should be an opportunity for engaging with health services and providing support for people who have substance dependency issues and need care and treatment. So that was the main thrust of our recommendations on treatment within custody, whether in a police cell or, in fact, in a prison context.
Thank you. Carol?
Yes, also thanks for the opportunity to speak to you today. I think that the work of the task force, we were always very keen that it should be evidence-based. And I think if we could make reference to the UK guidance on drug dependence and how it should be treated within the UK. Now, this highlighting of health inequalities is not unique to Scotland. And although the national guidelines on clinical drug misuse and dependence and how that should be managed were published by the Department of Health in England, they were endorsed by all four devolved nations. And I think what the task force saw was that though the evidence is there, it wasn't always in practice. That wasn't what people were experiencing. I think those guidelines are very clear that police custody, and there's a whole chapter within there on criminal justice settings. And I think that the transitions to, from and between different criminal justice settings were highlighted as there's evidence that these are potential transition points where if maintenance treatment on methadone or buprenorphine is not maintained, then there is a risk of relapse and overdose.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Fergus Ewing?
Yes, good morning to both witnesses. I wonder if I could ask you both two questions. The first one is, how important do you feel it is to embed the medication-assisted treatment standards in practice, especially in regard to ensuring that individuals receive appropriate medication whilst in police custody, a point which David Strang made clearly in his opening remarks?
So,
David?
Yep. Well, the answer to your question is very important, which is a cornerstone of the work of the task force, which actually predated my time as chair, but was the production of the medication-assisted treatment standards, the MAT standards, and these set out what standards people should expect if they're seeking assistance and service for drug dependency. One of the key MAT standards is about people getting access to support when they need it, and that they should have some say in what treatment they should receive in the same way as anyone might for other cases. The risk is that people don't get continued replacement therapy when they're in police custody, and that has a detrimental effect on their health, and I would say on their general well-being and their likelihood of reducing offending. So I think it's absolutely important that the MAT standards are met.
Good.
I'd go as far as to say it's essential.
Thank you. Well, thank you. I thought that would be the answer, and it's the answer, obviously, what one expected. I just wanted to ask one more question, which has two parts to it. The first is, are the witnesses aware of any data that exists on the availability of healthcare staff to administer methadone in police custody? So that's a general one, and I'm raising it because questions have been raised by the petitioner and others that there may not be sufficient staff, medical staff, appropriately qualified staff, to do the job of ensuring proper treatment in police custody. So that's the first one. And the second one, if I may ask, is that the petitioner has asserted that in NHS Grampian, there is what he considers to be the inappropriate prescription of a drug. I think it's dihydrocodeine, from memory. I wonder if either of the witnesses are able to comment on whether in their view this is inappropriate, or whether they have any information with regard to that. In saying that, we will perhaps make direct inquiries, to be fair to NHS Grampian, to put that point to them as well, as is right and proper. David.
Thank you. On that second point, I'm not a clinician, I can't comment on that. What we laid out in the task force report is the standard that we expect. Now, it'll vary across different police areas and NHS areas. I'm not aware of data about healthcare staff available in police stations.
Dr. Hunter?
I can't give you any information on the staffing either. Just to say, in terms of dihydrocodone, that is sometimes prescribed within custodial settings, and there's guidance within the previous UK guidance that I mentioned on exceptional, it shouldn't be routine as a replacement, but there are some exceptional circumstances, including when they can't get access to existing prescribed medication safely, when it would be used but by an experienced clinician.
Well, I'm most grateful to Dr. Hunter for that clarification, which is very useful, and we can pursue that further. But just going back to the first question, just about the availability of healthcare staff, I mean, since neither of you are able to give us information about this, can you suggest from whom we may be able to obtain information? And if the answer is that there is nobody from whom we can obtain that information because records are not properly kept, does that not point to a sort of lacuna in the system of oversight of the application of the correct treatment and sufficient medical personnel available to deliver it for those people in police custody who require it?
So, to be helpful with that, I could make inquiries and let the committee know to what extent it is available. In my saying that I'm not aware of its being available doesn't mean that it is not available. It may well be that at a local level or even nationally it's collated, but I'm just not aware of the data of healthcare staff available in police stations.
So it's a known unknown?
It's definitely a known unknown from my point of view.
Each health board should be able to give you that information in terms of the NHS staff that they have within settings. And I think you would also need to explore prescribing staff who may be different from those who can supervise once it has been prescribed.
Thank you very much again.
I mean, quite a bit of the evidence that we heard was not so much about ambition, about delivery of various things and principles. And Alexander Stewart's going to go on to ask a couple of questions in relation to this in a moment. But to go back to the medicated assisted treatment standards and the importance you attach to these being embedded, and I just want to refer back to that word. To what extent did the work that you did suggest how far away we were adrift from that principle in terms of actual delivery?
Considerably far short. So these standards were published in the spring of last year, 2021. And originally when the task force published them, the Scottish Government gave a commitment to implement them within a year. But in fact, that was overambitious. And when we have, in our report, have said that by 2024, we would expect them to be implemented. There was an audit and a report by Public Health Scotland, which showed where, I think they audited the first five MAT standards, and there was a report published in the spring of this year, a year on from the publication of the standards, showing where the shortfalls were, and they were substantial across Scotland. So this is an important piece of work that still needs to be delivered by local health boards, by alcohol and drug partnerships.
And before I come to Carol, I mean, and forgive me, just referring back to your very first answer, is this one of the things you have an ambition to include in the oversight role that you referred to in your opening response, in terms of seeking to ensure that these procedures are actually going to be effectively embedded? Is that part of the oversight function?
So the oversight group's function is to hold the government to account on the delivery of the national mission, and specifically the recommendations from the Changing Lives report. But it's also to give advice to the Scottish government. So it's got a twin role. Absolutely, we'll be looking at the implementation of the MAT standards with regular reports from. There's a MAT standard implementation team within the Scottish Government, and they will be reporting to the oversight group.
Okay. And thank you. Before I bring in Alexander Stewart, because he will pursue this, Carol Hunter, have you anything to add?
No, just to say that the MIST team, the implementation support team, is in place, working with ADPs on the implementation of the MAT standards.
Okay, thank you. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. And when we are talking about the medication-assisted treatment standards, and you've already alluded to that there are still potential gaps, can I ask if there's anything that the witnesses believe is still necessary to ensure that these standards are fully implemented and are working as intended?
So each area has been required to produce an action plan to say how they will implement these, what resource they need, and they've been directed by the minister to identify a lead person. Because one of the comments that we make in the report is that where you have collaborative working, often clear accountability for leadership can get diluted because people say, I thought they were doing it. So what has been identified is one person who has responsibility for leading that. And I think that's a helpful thing. Some of the issues will relate to training of personnel, so that might take some time. It might be about resourcing. But by focusing on these 10 standards, we're saying this is what needs to happen, and that should ensure consistency across Scotland. Because one of the comments and criticisms of drug support services across Scotland, that they're very patchy. They're different. Now, I accept that geography and particularly the cities will have a different footprint from rural areas. But if you are drug dependent and need support wherever you are in Scotland, you should be able to access it timely with the treatment that you need.
And you've identified there that there is a postcode lottery of some services depending on location, depending on geographical situations and circumstances. And I think that is important in this whole process, because if that is not fully implemented and working collectively across the whole state, across the whole of the country, then there are gaps that are massive for individuals, and they are at risk if they are in that situation.
Yes, I mean, postcode lottery, and I know you're using it in a sort of pejorative sense. People might argue for local flexibility, and there's a difference in the Scottish borders from in Edinburgh City, but broadly, yes, that everyone who needs treatment should be able to get it. And I suppose for things like residential rehabilitation, there may not be that in every local authority. There is a place, but there should be somewhere, wherever you live, that you can get access to whatever treatment you need, whether it's opioid substitute therapy or whether it is residential rehab.
Carol, do you have anything you wish to add to that?
I think I would add to that workforce recruitment is a challenge, and that's a challenge for every area of Scotland, no matter what the geography. There may be different challenges. I think speaking to my colleagues across Scotland, I think they all experience a recruitment challenge, and that will affect implementation.
Okay. And my next question is about, did the Scottish Government consult with the task force regarding the evidence gap that was identified when it came to prescription medication being available to individuals in custody? And if so, are there ways that the progress has been, and what progress has been made on that? Because you identified there was a gap in that process. And from that, have we seen any real progress?
I'm not able to say that. I mean, we published this in at the end of July, on the 21st of July, and I haven't seen the latest update on the implementation, so I don't have up-to-date information on that. I mean, obviously, our hope is that with the focus of this in the report, with the commitment to respond to the recommendations, that we would, as your question implies, hope to see an improvement, but I haven't seen the data yet.
But the gap was very much identified within the process.
Yes, I mean that's what's led to the MAT standards. Yes. Is saying that there's inconsistency across Scotland. We should have standards. Now that gap will vary across the geography of Scotland and depending on resourcing.
Okay, anything from you, Carol, on that?
Just to say that my experience in I'm recently retired as the lead pharmacist for the alcohol and drugs. I'm still working 2 days a week, though. Alcohol and drug services in Greater Glasgow and Clyde, there has always been good communication between police custody and collection. I mean, 20 years ago, we had developed a form for collection from pharmacies. So I don't think it's fair to say that there's a gap completely. I think there are hit patches of good practice there.
Thank you, convener.
I mean, obviously that was one of the most striking parts of our earlier evidence and consideration of the petition, is that it actually, from our point of view, took some time before we were able to get the government to accept that there did seem to be a breakdown in the demonstrability trail of a prescribed drug actually reaching the individual for whom it was intended. Not that the intention was there, not even that it might not be happening, but that subsequently it was impossible, really, through a lack of any national standard, to demonstrate that it had actually happened. And that was something I think that as a committee we felt was really quite a significant deficiency in a particular relation to the petitioner's experience, which obviously was very tragic and sad in its ultimate conclusion, and is the reason we pursue that point particularly.
I understand that.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to both our guests for their insights so far. I note the points raised by the task force, in particular in relation to Friday releases from custody. I think page 10 of the report that you published mentions that prison releases on a Friday or the day before a public holiday should be banned in order to give people a better chance to access supports. Have you had any further indication from the Scottish Prison Service or Police Scotland about that being a policy that they are willing to adopt?
Thank you for that question. So action 96 on page 73 of the report is the recommendation that the Scottish Government should change the legislation to implement a blanket policy of no liberations on a Friday or the day before a public holiday. So you're absolutely right that it was a key recommendation. There is legislation on the books at the moment which allows someone to be liberated early by a day if it's considered essential for them to get the support and treatment they need as they leave prison. But it's been used very rarely, and still the day of the week when most people are released from prison is the worst day for their health. It's a Friday. And the reason that Friday is such a high day is that, you know, the length of someone's sentence is calculated on the day of sentencing, and they'll know what day they should be released. Now, if that falls on a Saturday or a Sunday, they cannot lawfully be held to be released on the Monday, and so they have to be released on the Friday. So you end up with 3/7 of people being released on a Friday and 1/7 each on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday. And the reason that Friday is the worst day is that if someone has to, on the day of release, very often people haven't got the accommodation. If they've lost the tenancy while they've been in prison, they then have to go to the local authority housing office. They need to register with a GP if they're needing medication, and they have no money and they need to register for benefits at the DWP. So, and those services are often closed on a Friday afternoon and there's nothing on the Saturday or Sunday. So that was the reason. It's for people's health. We know that the day of release and the next 2 or 3 days are a really vulnerable time for drug overdoses and potential drug deaths. People's tolerance will have changed while they've been in prison, and if they, they're really at risk of succumbing to an overdose. So that's why we're saying, rather than it being discretionary, we're saying that it should be mandatory that people are not released on a Friday. And as I say, that there's no flexibility within the law. If they were kept the Monday, they'd be unlawfully detained. And at the moment, if they were released early, they'd be unlawfully liberated. So there needs to be a change in legislation to allow that. And the principle being that people leaving prisons should be well supported. They, I mean, ideally, they should have some accommodation, they should have the health care that they need and access to funds. And if we don't put those in place, we shouldn't be surprised that the level of reoffending is so high, because if someone goes out with no money, nowhere to live, and no lawful medication, then you can see what's going to happen.
To your point entirely, I think it's a really important one that you've made. Just even anecdotally from my own experience representing the largest prison in Scotland, Barlinnie, having visited it on several occasions, prison officers have quite candidly described to me that they've got repeat customers who they're liberating on a Friday and they'll go down to the city centre, will be shoplifting, purchasing drugs, taking drugs, usually in an unsafe way, and then will likely be arrested and back in the prison on the Monday. And effectively, they're serving life sentences in short bursts, but on a frequent basis. Yeah. But my point, I suppose, I'm asking you, and also having seen it, having participated in the unofficial overdose prevention pilot in Glasgow, frequently we'd have people turning up to the ambulance who had just come straight from Barlinnie or Lomas prisons, and were seeking to access, you know, a safe place to inject. But my point would be, like, you've made a very important recommendation. Has there been any indication from government that this is an urgent action they're willing to expedite? Is there any indication of timescales for adjustments?
So just as a side, I spent 5 years as a Majesty's Chief Inspector of Prison, so I'm very familiar with that picture that you describe. So our recommendation for the whole report was that the Scottish Government should produce an action plan, and we gave them 6 months. So that they haven't yet had that 6 months. So we haven't seen... We've seen a general response from the Drugs Policy Minister, Angela Constance, and, as you would expect, she's welcomed the report and said they'll look at it in detail and provide a report. And so the National Mission Oversight Group that I mentioned will receive from the Scottish Government their detailed response to each of the recommendations, the 20 recommendations and the 139 action points. So we're awaiting that. So the answer to your question is no, I haven't seen the response to that.
That's certainly helpful when we come to future evidence sessions, I think. Just if Dr. Hunter has any points that she'd like to make in relation to those questions that I'd asked.
I think I would. And I was on the Drug Desk Task Force as a representative of the Royal Pharmaceutical Society, and I think there's a wider role for pharmacy here. The guidelines that I mentioned earlier, the UK guidelines on clinical management, said that prescribing arrangements should be in place before someone is liberated, and that's a responsibility for healthcare professionals. And I think personally there's a lot more that community pharmacy could do there. There are, in my own health board, roughly 10% of the pharmacies are open 7 days a week, and some of them have late day opening till 10 o'clock at night. Not many, but there are some. And I don't think we utilise that enough, and we don't use the prescribing capacity enough within community pharmacy. And I think, you know, personally, communication is a key to this. And I think that we need to be a key partner.
Thank you very much for that. Really appreciate it. Another important point I noted in the task force raised was that people who use drugs should be provided with naloxone on liberation, which I think seems like a relatively straightforward recommendation to implement. Is there any indication that the government are adopting that policy and will instruct Police Scotland and the Scottish Prison Service to do that? Is there any indication at this stage? I know you mentioned you were awaiting a detailed report.
Thank you. I mentioned earlier that I previously was Chief Inspector of Prisons, and that was Scottish Prison Service policy that naloxone was offered. I mean, one of the successes, if you like, of the task force has been the rollout nationally of naloxone, and the Police Service of Scotland have committed to carrying all their frontline officers carrying naloxone. And in my time, that was pre-2018, people who were leaving prison, who were drug users, and their families were being offered naloxone kits. So I know that there has been, but I think, again, that was probably patchy, depending on local arrangements. So what we're wanting is a national consistency of making sure that naloxone is available, and clearly people leave prison are at high risk of being in the company of someone who overdoses or themselves. And so we're very positive about, or very strong on recommending that, that naloxone should be available as widely as possible.
That's great. And Dr. Hunter, do you have any point to make on that at all?
Yeah, as a former chair of the National Naloxone Advisory Group, when Mr. Ewing was the Health Minister, I think I think everyone should be carrying naloxone. And it's not just about supply from prisons, it's about the whole community coverage. That's really important, because we know that this post-liberation quite is a high risk of overdose.
If I may, convener, I just wanted to ask an additional supplementary point. Mr. Strang raised a really important point about community availability of supports, particularly on a Friday in that critical risk period on liberation. Dr. Hunter raised the point about community pharmacy availability and utilising that network more readily to support people. And obviously, we've mentioned naloxone. There's clearly an effort from the Scottish Government and the Health and Social Care Partnership in Glasgow, particularly to launch an official overdose prevention pilot in Glasgow. Do you have a view about how such a facility might assist people in that context where they're being liberated from prison and they don't have necessarily a safe place to go, or it might be an opportunity as a key interface for people who are in the justice system and being liberated? Could it be something that would add value?
So can I just check, are you referring to the supervised drug consumption facility?
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. So we make a key recommendation that that should be explored. Now, there are legislative problems, as you know, with that, with the policy on Misuse of Drugs Act still reserved to Westminster. But certainly, well, only Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS have been pursuing establishing a safer drug, a supervised drug consumption facility, with some assurance from the Lord Advocate that they will be allowed to do that. But the legislation itself is 50 years old and has some things that are unhelpful nowadays in terms of things like drugs paraphernalia, allowing premises to be used for injecting and so on. So the answer to your question is yes, if supervised drug consumption facilities were available, they would reduce the harms of drug taking and would increase access to healthcare and support.
Thank you very much. Dr. Hunter, have you any points?
Absolutely. I would fully support the implementation of a facility within Glasgow, and I'm part of the working group locally looking at that. I think providing a safe space where people can be supervised and there's someone there who can intervene if there's an overdose is hugely important. But these spaces and all the evidence across the world shows that they can encourage people into treatment and support them until they're ready to get into treatment. These supervised facilities, it's not just about preventing an overdose, it's about preventing bloodborne viruses and infections, and just generally promoting health and well-being. There's a huge number of benefits.
Sorry, I realise we're up against it, but just thank you very much for those points. I think that was really important and it helps to colour the overall context of this policy area. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Strang, you made reference to I think dozens of recommendations in the report. And I'm sorry we're not here to do full justice to the report this morning. The work of the committee has been very much focused on the issues raised in the petition, despite Mr. Sweeney's heroic efforts to and endeavours to draw out slightly wider evidence, which I'm sure is very useful to the committee as well. Is there anything we've not touched on this morning that either you or Carol Hunter would like to say in addition?
No, not in relation to the petition. I mean, I'm just grateful for your interest, and the more people read and take an interest in the report, then the better. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Carol Hunter?
No, nothing else from me.
Well, in which case, I'd like to thank you both very much. That's been very helpful in terms of the the very distressing petition that we've been giving our consideration. And I'd like to thank you both very much for being present remotely and in person with us today. And I'll suspend the meeting shortly, just after members have agreed that we're content to hear the evidence, to consider the evidence at our subsequent meeting. We are. Then I suspend briefly. Thank you very much. Welcome back. Petition number 1855 to pardon and memorialise those convicted under the Witchcraft Act of 1563. This was lodged by Claire Mitchell, QC, and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to pardon, apologise and create a national monument to memorialise those people in Scotland accused and convicted as witches under the Witchcraft Act of 1563. Members will recall that the First Minister has provided an apology to those people in Scotland accused and convicted as witches under the Witchcraft Act of 1563. And I seem to remember in evidence we heard some 2,200 people, the vast majority of whom were women. I'm actually not sure that the First Minister apologised to the men who were convicted under the Act. I have a recollection she apologised to the women who were convicted under the Act. So 400 people have gone without an apology, I think, at this point. We last considered the petition at our meeting on the 18th of May 2022, when we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and to Natalie Dawn MSP, and we now have responses from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, Natalie Dawn, and the petitioner. The Cabinet Secretary advised, while it is the Scottish Government policy that costs associated with creating and maintaining new memorials are not to be met from scarce public funds, the Government would be happy to consider helping to publicise any fundraising efforts. The Cabinet Secretary also indicated that the location of any national memorial would be primarily a matter for local authorities. And Natalie Dawn, MSP, has provided a brief update on the progress of her proposed Witchcraft Convictions Pardons Scotland Bill, letting us know that the consultation responses will be published shortly and that she intends to progress to the next stage of the Members' Bill process. The petitioner highlights the considerable work that has been undertaken to place in respect of pursuing the aims of the petition, including discussions with interested parties about taking forward plans for a National Museum, Memorial and Museum of Witch Hunts. And I think the petitioner has indicated that they are reasonably content as a consequence with the actions that have been taken in all three aspects of the petition as raised. Do colleagues have any suggestions as to how we might proceed from this point? Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I think you've summarised it really well about where we are in the process, and I think at this stage there isn't much requirement for this committee to take it much further. So I think it would be appropriate to close the petition under the Standing Order 15.7, because the First Minister, as you already indicated, has apologised to the women who were convicted, and Natalie Dawn is continuing to progress her members' bill, and the petitioner has indicated that the underway in undertaking is going forward for plans for the National Memorial. So I think under those circumstances, there is not much point in this committee progressing because things have already moved on considerably since.
Thank you. Are we, colleagues, content to close the petition as suggested by Mr. Stewart? I think we are. Thank you very much. Petition number 1887 to create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act, lodged by Nicola Murray. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act, creating a specific offence that enables courts to hand down longer sentences for perpetrators of domestic violence which causes miscarriage. Members will recall the evidence session that we held at our last meeting with stakeholders, who raised many important issues in relation to the petition. We also heard directly from the petitioner, Nicola Murray, about her personal experience and desire to see change in the current system. Now, in advance of this meeting, we've obviously had a chance to reflect on the evidence that we've considered, and I think it does afford us an opportunity just publicly to give some thought to what we have heard and how we might take matters further forward. Do colleagues have... I mean, obviously, this is one of the more important petitions we've heard, and I think we've all been very struck by the evidence as we've listened to it. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I entirely endorse what you've just said. The evidence of Nicola Murray was profoundly moving and extremely effective. And I think we all commended her bravery in speaking out in what it could not be a more sensitive matter. I think there is a bit more evidence we've yet to hear, so obviously we need to collate, obtain and consider that. But at present, I would be minded, I think, to go down the route on the principal matter in the petition of recommending that there should be a specific new statutory offence. I had raised with witnesses, including a last week, Dr. Neil, Dr. Scott and Mr. Tidy, the kind of alternative or possible alternative of seeking to use the existing law assault by libelling these particular circumstances, if you like, or possibly the other alternative of an aggravated offence, which I think Mr. Sweeney raised as well, as far as I can recollect. Those might be alternatives. But the evidence last week, Convener, I heard from, in particular, Dr. Neil, in dismissing this, I think was quite compelling. And what I took from her evidence was that she argued that although in theory the alternatives might work, in practice she felt that they wouldn't, and that the matter is of such gravity of the loss of an unborn child that it does merit a proper, distinct, separate, new statutory offence. She also pointed to the fact that that is the case in England and elsewhere, albeit that the law in England, I think, dates back to 1929 and was conceived for a different purpose altogether. Yeah. But be that as it may, I'm subject to learning a bit more information, I think, from the various legal authorities and relevant bodies from whom we can obtain evidence. My feeling changed, I think, from thinking that there might be an easier way, an existing alternative, to agreeing with the evidence we heard, which substantially was there should be a new statutory offence. And the other thing I would say, and this is an important point, although it's perhaps not the main point, is that the circumstances that the petitioner described, where she found that the charge had been reduced without her being consulted, I think that's profoundly wrong. And I think all the witnesses that we asked about that said so, and that must be changed. And some recommendations there and end would also be appropriate, in my opinion.
Thank you. Alexander Stewart?
I would concur, Convener. I think, as you've identified, this case has, this petition itself has been quite a harrowing one for the individuals involved, and there seems to be, without question, a gap that has arisen from the situation, and it would be appropriate for us to recommend that we do put forward a specific statutory offence, because I think that in itself would alleviate some of the problems that have been identified. And Fergus Ewing is quite correct when he talks about the difficulties that individuals have suffered in going through this process, but also it has been exacerbated and aggravated by circumstances and situations within agencies around that are there to support. And I think that needs to be advised, that there needs to be some clarity there. So I think by going down this route, that may give us the opportunity to ensure that some of these problems are ironed out and the individuals who go through this process don't suffer the same consequences as others have.
Mr. Sweeney, is there anything you'd want to add?
I recall Dr. Neil's evidence, which I thought was very helpful, in particular that I broached the idea of a member's bill as a potential remedy. She didn't find that convincing, and I tend to actually agree with her, and she said that it simply requires an amendment to the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018. That would be a smoother, more coherent way to remedy the matter. So I would recommend that we seek the government's agreement on that. I think that's definitely.
I mean, I very much agree. I mean, in the evidence that we've heard, and in particular the Scottish Government's initial response, superficially, the alternatives looked as if they might have been an effective way of proceeding. But I think, in the face of the evidence we've heard subsequently, I've been persuaded that it does require. The proposal for the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act to have a specific charge included within it. And I was struck wearing a completely different hat, my SPCB hat, Scottish Parliament Corporate Body hat, that we have 17 members' bills already before Parliament in this session, which is a record number of members' bills. And the prospects really now of additional members' bills finding any scope to proceed before 2026 are really probably nil. So either we take the view that this is just something we are going to nod at and move along from, having said it's all very terrible, or I think we have to be much more prepared to take a more decisive action. So I agree. I think Mr. Ewing did draw attention to the fact that we discovered that the offence in England and Wales, which until we heard that, I think maybe we assumed had been brought in for the purpose, actually had grown out of provisions that had been passed at a much earlier time and to meet entirely different circumstances. So I think we'd like to hear a bit more about that. But I think the feeling of the committee is that we would like the clerks to proceed to potentially prepare for us an appropriate representation that we consider to the Scottish Government, subject to that final evidence being heard, which would recommend, on behalf of this committee, this specific offence being included within legislation. Yeah. Mr. Ewing?
Yeah, it was just a suggestion for consideration. I really thought this through, and as I said earlier, there's more evidence that we've got to obtain. But because the issue raised by the petitioner is such gravity, I did wonder if this might be a candidate for a possible debate from this committee to the Parliament, in order that, if you like, the oxygen of transparency, openness, and the opportunity to other members to contribute would be available. Because I know we want to use this sparingly, convener, and I don't have knowledge of how sparingly has been in the past. You will, of course. But nonetheless, I felt instinctively this is such a profoundly emotional, emotive and important, sensitive issue that there would be a considerable interest from other members in hearing more about this.
Yeah, I mean, we've actually identified a number of candidates that we think might be suitable for a chamber debate, but I think where potentially we are going to make a very specific recommendation in respect of the action that we think that might be appropriate going forward, it may well be that we would like to see that added to the potential things that we could seek to raise as a chamber debate. Because it will be, you know, quite a consequential recommendation, I think, arising from a very sensitive petition that's been raised with us. Are we happy to consider that?
Yeah, I would just make the point. I believe that Dr. Neil has pretty much written and drafted the relevant amendment. You know, so it's a question of just, you know, offering that to the government as something to adopt. And then I will also note that Mr. Tidy mentioned in his evidence about amending the Sentencing Council's guidelines for judges. And that might be a more immediate goal. I think that must be worth noting as well as a potential action that we can recommend.
I'm happy to see us take that forward as well. Are we content? So we keep the petition open and we proceed on that basis. And can I thank again the petitioner for the time that they took in speaking to us, and also to our witnesses last week who helped inform our discussion. We move to petition number 1896. Provide every primary school child in Scotland with a reusable water bottle. This was launched by Callum Eisted. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to replace the disposable water bottle provided with primary school lunches with a sustainable reusable metal bottle. During our last consideration of the petition, we were very fortunate to hear from Callum personally, and as members will recall, the youngest ever petitioner to present to the Scottish Parliament. And we've got to thank Callum not just for his evidence, but his petition was specifically cited in the award which the committee subsequently received as a mover and shaker from the Holyrood Magazine of the Year awards. Callum explained why reusable water bottles are important, and told us about his campaign work, including an impressive fundraising exercise. The committee agreed to write to the First Minister, who Callum met, to ask what action she intends to take in order to fulfil the ask of the petition. I regret to say we've not received a response from the First Minister on this petition to our representations, and I understand that Callum is also waiting on an update from the First Minister in respect of the petition and other matters that were raised with the First Minister. So in thanking Callum again for his evidence and time he's taken with the petition, do members have any comments or suggestions as to how we might proceed? Mr. Stewart?
Thank you, Convener. It has to be said that I am disappointed that Callum has not received, and neither have the committee, received any further information back, because there was a huge amount of publicity, and to have such a young individual who was quite inspiring to come that day and give his evidence, I would have hoped that he'd have been treated slightly better than that. But we are where we are. But I think it is now, once again, time to write back to the First Minister, seeking an update on where we are with this petition. Because, as I say, when we received the information and we had Callum here, there was a real buzz about the possibility of this becoming a real potential, because he had put so much effort into it. And I think, as I said, it's disappointing that effort has not been given the full credit that it deserves. But I do think, as I say, we need to write back to the First Minister and to invite the Cabinet Secretary of Net Zero Energy and Transport to give evidence as to where things might be going with the petition to fulfil the aims that Callum has put forward, because his objectives and his ambition were fantastic, and we should be encouraging as much as we can to ensure that that dream for him becomes a reality. Thank you.
Are we content, colleagues, to proceed on that basis? We'll write back to the first. I should note in passing the further representation we've received from Sue Webber in relation to this. So I think we could write to the First Minister seeking an update, expressing our disappointment, really, that neither we nor Callum have received any response, particularly given the personal engagement the First Minister had with Callum on his occasion of giving evidence to the committee. Thank you. Petition 1906, investigate options for removing and reducing the impact of the Central Glasgow section of the M8. Lodged by Peter Kelly on behalf of At Replace the M8. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to commission an independent feasibility study to investigate scenarios for reducing the impact of the M8 between the M74 and Glasgow Cathedral, including specifically the complete removal and repurposing of the land. At our last consideration of this petition on the 23rd of February, we agreed to write to stakeholders seeking the views on the action called for in the petition. Glasgow City Council highlighted its commitment to address the aims of the petition as part of its Council Strategic Plan 2022-27, and they have committed to commission research on and explore options to reduce the impact of the M8 on the city centre and review opportunities to re-engineer other roads infrastructure to become more people-friendly, including options for long-term replacement. They also state that funding and collaboration with stakeholders such as Transport Scotland are required to take this research forward. We have also had submissions from Professor Richard Williams, providing information on a recent project in Sao Paulo, and from Professor Williams, who supports the petition. The submission from Dr. Wood highlights relevant traffic reduction projects in other parts of the UK and the related economic development opportunities in consequence. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Sweeney, you had a particular interest in this petition, I recall.
Yes, Convener. I think it's certainly a positive indication from Glasgow City Council that they are seriously investigating this, not the least that they have submitted a levelling up fund application worth £50 million to the UK government to finance the capping of the M8 at the Mitchell Library at Charing Cross. However, the asset itself is owned by the Scottish Government and Transport Scotland and its agencies. So it would be good for this committee to establish what exactly is the nature of the cooperation that is required from all levels of government, from Council to Transport Scotland as the agency, to deliver the best outcome for the city. So I think in that regard, we haven't fully established the nature of how that is cooperating. It might be one thing for Glasgow City Council to have a position, which, whilst positive, isn't necessarily specific in its actions. It has one levelling up fund bid in, but there isn't any indication from the Scottish Government via its agency, Transport Scotland, about what their intentions are, both at a strategic or an operational level, to affect this or to cooperate with the Council. Furthermore, I thought Dr. Wood's points were really important in terms of an international dimension to it in some of the work that this chap has done. So perhaps there is something in requesting a response from Transport Scotland or the Minister in relation to this matter. And then we can assess what the Scottish Government's position is in light of the evidence we've received.
Well, we could write to the Scottish Government and to ask them to facilitate a collaborative approach between Transport Scotland, the City Council, to see what the impact, the progress in all of this could be. And also, I think, to clarify what the funding mechanism for the outcomes of that might be.
I think that would be helpful.
Sensible.
Yeah, I think that would be helpful.
Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I just wanted to ask what other evidence we've obtained I mean, plainly, petitioners have expressed their view, as have a few others, but being someone who's not unfamiliar with the M8, I'm a bit unsure as to how it could be removed, which is what the petition calls for. And it does occur to me that there are a huge number of impacts that would have on the flow of traffic, the conduct of business, the conveyance of emergency vehicles to and from hospital, and generally the system of transport that we have in Scotland does depend, whether we like it or not, substantially on roads. I wonder, therefore, if we should be seeking evidence more widely, convener, in order to get a rounded view, and in particular from bodies such as the Glasgow Chamber of Commerce, the motoring organisations, the REC and so on, and the police and emergency services. I mean, I appreciate there's a huge range of possibilities here, from some which are relatively modest to complete removal of the road, or indeed shutting the road at weekends or whatever. But I'm just struck that we don't appear, as far as I know, and I'm sorry if I haven't picked up all of this in the papers from the clerks. I did raise this with the clerks in correspondence just last week. Well, whether we should cast our net a bit more widely and get a rounded view of... Yeah.
A perfectly reasonable point, Mr. Young. I mean, there's two things. I mean, first of all, I think Mr. Sweeney referred to the capping of the M8. I mean, for those people who are familiar with the Charing Cross end of it in Glasgow, I mean, it is really a valley through civilisation when you get to the top end of Glasgow. But I think probably, I think the points you make are perfectly fair. Perhaps we could suggest those organisations being included in our approach to the Scottish Government in terms of any collaborative approach that was being undertaken between Transport Scotland and the City Council to also include the various agencies that you've just identified? Could we do it that way?
Yes, happy to do that.
Because ultimately I think this would have to be a project that was taken forward by others, but I take the point that I think it would have to include a much wider range of views just to be certain that it was ultimately viable, in addition to any capping proposal that might proceed.
Yeah, I would agree, convener. I think the point that Mr. Ewing makes is very important. I think perhaps the removal in a broad sense is perhaps a bit of a provocation. But the question then is, it kind of goes into more kind of nuanced detail in the petitioner's detailed comments, which is talking about specific interventions that would reduce its impact, such as capping or constructing buildings on the airspace above the, or the air rights above the road, or perhaps areas where it is over-engineered. For example, the Townhead interchange was built for a flank of the motorway that was never built. So it's actually a massively over-engineered solution that could be deconstructed in large part without having any material effect on traffic. So there could be ways in which this could be done. I think the point the petitioner is perhaps trying to drive at is, pardon the pun, is that it's never been seriously reflected on by the Scottish Government, Transport Scotland. It's only recently the City Council has adopted thinking on this. So it feels like there's an opportunity for this committee to sort of be a catalyst. So there we are.
Thank you. No, I've just resolved not to reach for any other metaphors at this point in order. But I mean, I take the point. But so I think we could proceed on the basis that we've described with that understanding in part. Petition number 1930, to ensure customers are always given information on the cheapest possible fare in a new ScotRail contract, lodged by George Ecton, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that a requirement of all future rail contracts is for customers to be given information on the cheapest possible fare as a matter of course, and recognise the vital role of the existing ticket office estate in delivering on the same. And we've been joined this morning once again by Monica Lennon. Good morning, Monica. Lovely to have you with us again. And we'll hear from you in just a moment. The committee previously considered the petition at our meeting on the 29th of June, just before the summer recess, when we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and Transport for London. I'm pleased to say we've now received responses from Transport Scotland, Transport for London, as well as two submissions from the petitioner. Transport Scotland have indicated that the Scottish Government are considering whether Scottish Rail Holdings Limited will be covered by the consumer duty legislation. Their response also contained information on the progress and purpose of the Fair Fares Review, which is expected to be concluded in full at some point during next year, 2023, as well as the work being undertaken to develop and trial smart ticketing options. The response from Transport for London provides information on how their fare capping and pay-as-you-go system operates and the work that goes into ensuring customers can trust and always be charged the correct fare for their journey. The petitioner has also been in touch to update the committee on the FOI requests he has made to ScotRail about how the £5 city-to-city advance fares are advertised, and Mr Ecton has shared information on how easy it is for passengers to miss out on cheaper fares when using this ScotRail app, and he set out his view on why ScotRail should be included in the consumer duty. And before I open this up to wider discussion with members of the committee, I invite Monica Lennon if she would like to speak in support of the petition.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. It's lovely to be back. An award-winning committee. So that's me trying to soak in with you all. And just to say, I was listening patiently at the back, and I was in West Lothian at an event. It's not my area, but Callum was mentioned and is a superstar. So he does have lots of fans. So I wish the committee well with your endeavours in that front. I wanted to come along to support George Ecton's petition because the issues raised are not a surprise to me and my staff when we look at the emails that we get. So even before the pandemic, people would often get in touch out of frustration about the price of rail travel and at times the reliability of service. And then I took on the role as patron of Disability Equality Scotland, which I think has helped me to appreciate even more the points that Mr Ecton makes about the ease of getting information. So I really commend him for the efforts he's made, and I've looked at the correspondence between him and the Advertising Standards Authority, and it just shouldn't be that difficult. And again, the issue about access to staff and ticket officing is really important as well. So this has been an issue of interest to me before the pandemic, certainly in the context of climate emergency, because you know, we need a modal shift. We need to get people onto Scotland's sustainable rail network. And we can only do that if the public have confidence and can afford to use our rail services. I know that the predecessor committee looked at a petition from Mr Ecton before, and that was closed on the basis that the Scottish Government had given undertakings, and you know, from reading the petitioner's submissions, it looks like that's not been fulfilled. Now, colleagues may know I'm also a member of the Net Zero Energy Transport Committee. I don't speak on behalf of the committee today, but we've had a chance to ask the Cabinet Secretary and officials about the Fair Fares Review. It is frustrating that we don't have a clearer timeline other than 2023. I think the indication is early 2023, but in my experience in this parliament, that can be the summer, and then summer becomes winter and Christmas. So I think we need certainty on that, and that's why I feel, although the Fair Fares Review looks at wider issues, Mr Ecton's petition should be considered and should inform that work. It's timely we're meeting today. I was looking at the newspapers today, and there's reports that ScotRail's commuter numbers are down 40%. That then means that revenue is down. Looks like around 20% on pre-pandemic figures. So there's a big issue here in terms of giving people confidence. Now, part of the explanation is that, you know, people who have the option to work from home are choosing to do that. But many workers are taking into account the costs of getting to work, the cost of getting around. So if they have the choice, many will say, I'll work at home and I won't be in the office. I'm also concerned for those constituents due to medical appointments and other issues who can't be flexible when they travel, that they're often not getting access to the most affordable fares. So I have a view that we should be abolishing peak time fares. I think that should be looked at in terms of the fare review. I think Mr Acton's petition, again, I can't speak for the Net Zero Energy Transport Committee, but clearly he's raising matters that are of interest to our committee. I note what Transport Scotland have said, and I also note the information that's come from Transport for London. I think it was very helpful that Mr Sweeney MSP prompted that as well. So where we can look at good practice and other practice, I think that's important. But I think what's also really key to Mr Acton's aspirations is that we have a rail service in Scotland that is properly staffed. And if the committee's not aware, I would point you to the document prepared by Scotland's four rail unions. It was published in October of last year, A Vision for Scotland's Railways. And often we hear that when people are asking for things in Parliament, we talk about challenges rather than solutions. That document has lots of good policy in there. To be fair to Scottish Government, some of it's been actions already. But I think it's really important to look at that document as well, because one of the things, and if we just look at the executive summary, in terms of having the sustainable rail network we want to see, they talk about reducing ticket prices, abolishing peak fares and simplifying the ticketing system. Now, my understanding is the Scottish Government hasn't formally responded to that document by the four rail unions. I will declare I'm a member of Unite the Union and a member of the RMT Parliamentary Group, but I think it's a good document that's had some, cross-party support. So, yes, really pleased to have the chance to speak in favour of the petition today. I'll be happy to answer any questions, but I hope that this is an issue that can be kept open and explored by colleagues across Parliament and indeed Government.
Right, OK, thank you. Sorry, we're not a witness, so we can't ask you questions. We're just here to hear you speak to the petition. Having heard that, colleagues, is there anything colleagues would like to recommend by way of actions as to how we might proceed? Mr Sweeney?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to Monica Lennon, MSP, for coming along today and offering such a compelling point about why this petition is so important and that this committee should continue to consider it. I was struck by the submissions respectively from the Scottish Government and Transport for London, particularly the account from Transport Scotland that ScotRail had delivered a pilot for account-based ticketing, allowing for fare capping and tap-in, tap-out technology. The pilot took place on the Cathcart Circle for a period of 4 months, and though proving to be a good customer proposition, it was deemed unsuccessful on commercial grounds. ScotRail has since been transferred to public ownership, and that an account-based ticketing trial has been included within its business plan. I'm not satisfied with that response. I think that's totally inadequate, particularly when viewed in contrast to Transport for London, which says the core principle of their fare system is to make it as simple as possible, that we have a best value promise that when travelling, pay as you go on a Oyster or contactless debit card, credit card. Customers just need to touch in and out when travelling on our services, and we ensure that customers pay the cheapest possible fare for the journeys they make, and that is equivalent to no more than an equivalent travel card. Will automatically refund where journeys haven't been completed. I mean, it's night and day. It's honestly the most stark contrast in submissions I've seen to this committee in recent times. So I think there is something in this. The contrast between the two submissions was quite striking, and I think there's an opportunity for this committee to sort of probe it further.
I certainly would be willing to see us try and tease that explanation out further. Of course, Transport for London will be dealing with tens of millions of people using the system, and I don't know when the pilot is referred to as being useful but not necessarily cost-effective on a commercial basis. That may be a reflection of the numbers involved in relation to the cost of setting it up. I don't know. I mean, I certainly do think that any citizen of Glasgow who travels abroad is surprised at how far behind in terms of smart technology we actually are in you know, our largest city in Scotland. So I think there's more work that we could tease out in relation to that.
I did think it was interesting that I knew nothing about the pilot, you know, and I don't know how many Glaswegians knew about the pilot, but what I did know in London is it says we issue press releases publishing changes to fares and have high-profile advertising campaigns to highlight the cheapest way to travel in London. These can be seen in media advertising or on our services, but also that they have seen strong growth in the adoption of pay-as-you-go, which is over 70% of all journeys on TfL now using pay-as-you-go. And I take the point about population density and scale, but nonetheless, there are equivalent-sized cities to, you know, Glasgow, for example, which have this technology and works very successfully. And I wonder whether sometimes there's maybe a risk aversion whereby we don't persist with something that might initially make a bit of a loss, but actually in the longer term or even medium term, it will crowd in a lot more people using it because it's much more convenient. And as a perception change, perhaps there is something in that where we're too timid.
It strikes me as peculiar that we've introduced barrier technology at a whole series of stations, but actually we can't program the barriers to be pay-as-you-go, which I wouldn't have thought was impossible. So, I mean, can we establish who we think it would be best to try and pursue those issues with? I mean, I think meanwhile we should be writing to the Scottish Government to clarify when they'll confirm that Scottish rail holdings will be covered by the consumer duty legislation. And if it considers that Scottish Rail Holdings is not covered, to ask what action the Scottish Government proposes to take to ensure Scottish Rail Holdings will be covered by the consumer duty legislation. I think that is a deficiency. And I mean, I was also struck by Mr. Ecton on the evidence he submitted in his latest submission and how easy it was to miss out on the advertising. So I think Scottish Rail Holdings on the action they are taking to ensure that that is something people can easily identify. And I'd be very interested to know what advertising they do, how they evaluate and how sustained that actually is themselves in terms of the success that they think that has. Because obviously the petitioner feels it's easy to miss out on. Any other thoughts or comments, Mr. Stewart?
Can I just thank Monica Lennon for her presentation this morning too, convener. I think she made some very valid points on behalf of the petitioner and the way going forward. And you've identified that the advertising is one of the biggest issues. And I think that there is a need for us to find out what action is being taken. Because, you know, when someone purchases a ticket, 9 times out of 10 now, it's not with an individual, it's with a machine. And the machine tells you what the price of the ticket is. So you don't necessarily have the ability to understand what options are available because you hit the button and it tells you what you can have. And that maybe is not going giving us the cheapest value or the process. So I think some of that needs to be looked at. You've talked about technology and the way ensuring that some of that can be developed. But I do think there's room for improvement as to how that can be managed on the ground.
Mr. Ewing.
Yeah, I guess I should preface my remarks by saying that I still feel as if I'm serving my apprenticeship in this committee. So I may be slightly premature for me to say this, but I just kind of wonder if we're not just moving a bit beyond the specific ask in this petition to have a kind of general tour de table discussion about the rail service in Scotland, which of course is perfectly interesting and valid, but I mean, just getting back to what the petition says, it's very narrowly focused, and I'm not dismissing any of the points that have been made before us today, but is it not our primary role to focus pretty forensically and ruthlessly on what the petitioner actually asked for, rather than
I think that's
fish every ocean in the sea. Let's stick to our own waters.
Yes, I think that's a perfectly fair observation. I mean, we do actually have to ally. I think the actions that we've discussed can be brought back to the actual aim of the petition. But I agree. I think we have to be careful. I welcomed everything Monica Lennon had to contribute, it did invite us to stray slightly beyond in a number of areas the specific ambition of the petition. And I think we've got to, I mean, we're always willing to receive an additional petition from another party on all these other matters. But if we open up an inquiry in the broadest possible terms in relation to every petition, then we'll be trawling very deep, to extend your own metaphor. Mr. Ewing, are we content to proceed on the basis of the various recommendations we've had?
Just the point that Mr. Ewing makes, I think the important thing to focus on is the submission from TfL discussing the technology solution that does deliver the petitioner's request.
Think, yep.
And I think that the question is then, why is it that ScotRail are reticent to adopt such technology when it's clearly deliverable in other jurisdictions in the UK and internationally? Yep. And I'm not convinced by their response.
No. And I think that's a fair point, which relates back to the petition, as I said. So.
And it's kind of it's maybe analogous to the High Owl investigation, where it was like the technology of the air traffic control system. Maybe not entirely about the impact on jobs, but I think there is maybe something about the technology solution to deliver an outcome on performance in transport, and the kind of unconvincing response from ScotRail. I don't know if there is some sort of engineering expertise that we could.
Well, I think let's, in the first instance, pursue the issue a little bit further and see where that takes us.
Sure.
And we can consider that response again in due course. Petition number... Thank you very much, Monica. Petition number 1933 to allow the Forneti survivors to access Scotland's redress scheme, lodged by Iris Tinto on behalf of the Forneti survivors. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to widen access to Scotland's redress scheme to allow Forneti survivors to seek redress. We were going to be joined by Martin Whitfield, who unfortunately has had to go to a meeting elsewhere, but we are joined by Brian Whittle, MSP, who has an interest in this position, and so we welcome you, Brian, to the committee this morning. We previously considered the petition on the 15th of June, and at that time, we agreed to write to the Deputy First Minister, Glasgow City Council, and bodies representing victims and survivors of abuse. And since then, the committee has received responses from the Deputy First Minister, from Glasgow City Council, Victim Support Scotland, the Moira Anderson Foundation, the National Association for People Abused in Childhood, Future Pathways, and also from the petitioner. And copies of these responses were included in the papers for today's meeting. And our meeting papers summarise some of the issues that have been raised. Now, members will also be aware that representatives of the Forneti Survivors Group visited the Scottish Parliament very recently on the 27th of October, and their exclusion from the redress scheme was raised directly with the First Minister in First Minister's questions on that day. The written evidence we've received from organisations who represent and support victims and survivors of abuse suggests there is support for widening the eligibility criteria to include survivors who experience abuse during short-time respite or holiday care. Now, the Deputy First Minister states that it was always the Scottish Government's intention to exclude arrangements where there was no exercise of public function in either the provision of accommodation or the reason for the child being resident in the care setting. The responses from both the petitioner and Glasgow City Council highlight that records relating to Forneti House are limited, and it strikes me that it might not be possible to establish one way or another the reason for a child's stay at Forneti to meet the kind of proviso that the Deputy First Minister has stipulated was to form the basis of their exclusion. And therefore, before we open up to members of the committee to see how we might proceed, I wonder, Brian, if there's anything you would like to say in support of the petition.
Thank you, Convener, and I'm really happy to have the opportunity to once again speak on this issue. I think on the outset, I don't know if the committee have seen this in the last term, the Education Committee did a really in-depth and comprehensive report as the bill was coming through Parliament, which I would recommend. And I think that sexual abuse, and specifically child sexual abuse, has been swept under the carpet for too long, with victims left without the support that they desperately need. And as many colleagues will be aware, this is an issue that I have been working on with constituents for a number of years. And I think it's fair to say that my understanding of the trauma suffered by constituents over a prolonged period of time as they seek justice and redress, my discomfort and disquiet in the way victims are re-traumatised and are open to suffer secondary abuse continues to rise. Now, the redress scheme was designed to make it easier to access than taking a case through the civil court. However, the Criminal Injuries Compensation Authority already have a similar redress scheme where the decision is based on the balance of probabilities. This is different from a criminal court, which decides on the basis of beyond reasonable doubt, and the victim does not need to wait for the outcome of a criminal trial if there's already enough information to make a decision on that case. Though, crucially, though, contrary to what the bills suggest or the legislation suggests, the victim would waive their right to future civil action and any subsequent payment from a civil action. And a CICA compensation payment would require that the CICA payment should be reimbursed. I welcome the redress scheme, but I do think it's flawed. Most importantly is the fact that the redress bill was designed to provide financial redress to survivors of historical sexual abuse in care in Scotland. Welcome though that is, it is too narrow in its scope. And when I did question the Deputy First Minister on the eligibility criteria and that the victims of sexual abuse, for example, in a school setting, should also be included, he responded by saying that the scheme was designed to compensate those where the state undertook parental responsibilities, i.e. the care home. However, Convener, the 1989 Education Scotland Bill uses the term in locus parentis, which in effect transfers temporary parental responsibilities to the school and many other instances where this could be true, specifically for the Ferneithi survivors. That being the case, this bill is flawed and could leave the government, I believe, open to a potential challenge in the European Court of Human Rights and by the Equalities Commission because of its inequality of approach to the victims of a crime, especially such a heinous crime. You may be aware that there was a related case where the judge found that the Irish government had misrepresented a ruling by the European Court of Human Rights by excluding children abused in Irish schools from a redress scheme. And although I accept that the issues in that ruling are not exactly the same, it does suggest that this bill could be open to a similar legal challenge. And again, the Ferneithi survivors sit directly in that path. The bill, I say, is very welcome and was very welcome, but I do think it's incumbent upon us to ensure that it can be the very best it can be for all those who have been victims of such a horrendous crime and have to carry that burden throughout their lives. Financial redress will not heal the wounds, but at least will perhaps give them comfort that their voices have been heard and that there is an acceptance that they have been victims. However, I think there's more needs to be done in understanding that journey of the victims, those who speak out or those who initially cannot, the repeated trauma of retelling their story to multiple agencies, the lack of accessibility and adequate support from those have all become part of the jigsaw. I have absolutely no doubt that the government have a commitment to those who have suffered such a crime, but I do think they need to be braver and they need to look beyond the limitations in which way this bill is currently deployed to those who have suffered in a similar ways but are currently excluded, i.e. the Ferneithi survivors. And if we do not, and will only require this legislation further down the road to change and be amended, I think we need to make the bill everything it could be. And I speak on behalf of Ferneithi survivors and all those other child abuse victims who are yet to have similar redress. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Whittle. Colleagues, I mean, I think the Deputy First Minister, in identifying that the intention was to exclude arrangements where there was no exercise of public function, is compromised slightly when it's clear that it just simply may not be possible to establish one way or another the reason for a child's stay at Ferneithi. And I wonder, you know, in the light of what Mr. Whittle said, the further evidence we've received, if colleagues have any suggestions as to how we might proceed next. Mr. Ewing?
The Deputy First Minister in his reply did say that it would be open to the Ferneithi sufferers of non-recent abuse to make application under the existing scheme. In other words, he didn't say that they were ineligible. In fact, the implication, I think, as I took it, Convener, from his reply to the committee was that, in fact, they may be eligible. The difficulty is, as you've said, is how can that be proven if the records are not there? I wonder whether we might make a suggestion of a sort of solution for Ferneithi victims, that given it is not possible for them to demonstrate that how they came to be in care, that they should be given the benefit of the doubt. Would that be something which is possible? Because if someone is denied the opportunity to provide evidence because of the fact that, frankly, public authorities have not kept that evidence properly and they have mislaid it or they can't find it, that's not the fault of the survivors. And I wonder whether, I know it's not an in principle answer, because personally, I think that if one has suffered in care, then the explanation of how you came to be in care is really not relevant. I think a victim is a victim, and as victim support argue in their reply, all victims should be entitled to redress. But that's an easy principle to expound, more difficult to put into practice. And I know it has been considered by the Education Committee in far more detail, and I must confess I haven't studied that, so I should put that in the record. And maybe there are other arguments that I haven't considered. But in order to get a solution for these petitioners, I wonder if we might make the point that it's simply not possible for these victims to provide evidence that they came to be in care because of a decision taken by a public authority, even although it does appear to me that that was almost certainly the explanation for most cases of children who found themselves at this unfortunate place.
Yes, I mean, I'm very supportive of that suggestion. Does Mr. Stewart?
I would concur with Mr. Ewing, convener. I think that he identifies an area that requires to be looked at. And it is difficult, as Mr. Whittle has said, not to include these individuals from the circumstances and situation they found themselves in. So I would be very supportive of Mr. Ewing's proposal that we attempt to try and move this into that area, because by doing that, it will then give some redress to those individuals who find themselves in this situation.
Are we agreed that we would take it forward? I think what we would do is invite the clerks to draft a response for us to consider along those lines, based on the evidence that, you know, we've already gathered from a number of sources, but in particular, I think, in relation to that point. And now, it would be unusual, but I will let you come back in, Mr. Whittle. You're not here to assist us in our deliberations, but merely to lobby us as we consider them.
Thank you, Kuna. I do know it's unusual to be brought back in. But to Mr. Ewing's point, one of the things that I have highlighted over the time is the lack of record keeping across all local authorities, which seems to be really hampering. But the key here is you only have to have probability. You don't have to have proof. And the other one I want to underline is the phrase in locus parentis. That is key to your deliberations. Thank you for allowing me back in.
Have been noted. Thank you very much. So we'll keep the petition open and we'll proceed on that basis. Thank you, Mr. Whittle. That brings us to agenda item 2 at 11:54, which is consideration of new petitions. The first of those is petition 1954 to stop installing telegraph poles lodged by Lorna Bunting. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the current permitted development rights for digital communications infrastructure to encourage the use of underground ducting for new broadband service installations and avoid the installation of unsightly telegraph poles and overhead cables. To ensure local communities are made aware of plans to install digital communications infrastructure in their area and given an opportunity to share their views prior to any installation work taking place, and ensure that all digital infrastructure, including underground ducting, is routinely maintained by the developer. Lorna tells us that as part of the rollout of ultra-fast full-fibre broadband, Openreach have erected hundreds of telegraph poles across Lennox Town and Milton of Campsie. This work was carried out without prior consultation with the local community. And having not received prior notice, Lorna goes on to tell us that local residents raised objections with Openreach about the installation of the telegraph poles, only to receive what they felt were unhelpful and dismissive responses. Now, as we do with all new petitions, the committee requested an initial view from the Scottish Government. And in responding to this request, the Scottish Government highlight that while land use planning is a devolved power, telecommunications remains a reserved matter. In response to the petition's aim to amend permitted development rights, the Scottish Government notes that the permitted development right for digital communications infrastructure was included in phase one of their review of permitted development rights and was amended following a public consultation in August 2020. Having been recently reviewed and updated, the Scottish Government believe the current provisions strike an appropriate balance and have no plans to further amend permitted development rights in this area. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action?
Thank you, convener.
Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, convener. I note the comments that the petitioner has made, and it's very interesting to see the information that's come back from the Scottish Government in their response. But I do think that, you know, when we're looking at the permitted development rights with reference to this, that I'm not sure we can take it much further in reality, convener. So I would propose that we close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government have recently reviewed and updated these permitted development rights for digital infrastructure, considered the current position and to strike an appropriate balance, and there are no current plans for further amendments to the permitted development rights in the area.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. Mr. Ewan, I think I saw you nodding in assent to that.
I agree with that, yes.
Is that, we generally agree? Well, we thank the petitioner, but in review of the response we've received, we will close the petition under 15.7, given the response of the Scottish Government on this occasion. Petition number 1955, to make the provision of public toilets a statutory duty on local authorities, lodged by John Wood, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure local authorities provide good quality, clean and accessible public toilets by placing a statutory duty on local authorities to provide adequate public toilets and ensuring sufficient funding is available to local authorities to meet this requirement. The Spice briefing highlights a 2018 BBC report which revealed that 15 of the 28 Scottish councils that responded to an FOI request had fewer public toilets in 2018 than they did in 2010. The briefing also points to a comfort scheme which runs in a number of local authorities, and the scheme provides grants to businesses and organisations when they register to become providers of toilet facilities, something of which I have to say I was unaware. The Scottish Government response states that there are no plans to make the provision of public toilets a statutory obligation on local authorities, and it points to the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund, which includes projects, proposals to deliver new public toilets, car parking and waste disposal facilities. In response to the Scottish Government, the petitioner says that the provision of public toilets is a basic requirement for public and environmental health, not simply an optional tourism issue. And John points out that the Scottish Government's role in ensuring health and environmental protection as a demonstration of why this issue is of national importance. Now, I note from a motion submitted by one of our parliamentary colleagues, this is National Toilet Week, which was also something I was unaware of. So we are considering the petition at an apposite moment, but I wonder if members or colleagues have any comments they might like to suggest in by way of taking the issue forward. Mr. Ewing.
Appropriate and very convenient. I think there is in principle a very strong argument behind this, but I wonder whether one option we might pursue, which would be of a more of a practical nature, which I appreciate probably is perhaps not absolutely what the petitioner wants, but something that we might want to consider is whether we could ask if the Scottish Government believe that the Rural Infrastructure Fund could be continued, extended. I know that it is a popular financial provision with local authorities and the Scottish Government. It's fairly flexible. I know in Highland that it has been very well used to address local issues of concern in places like Skye, the Fairy Pools, for example, where kind of long-standing local community issues can find a solution. And therefore, because of that experience, I wonder whether we might perhaps even encourage the Scottish Government to work with local authorities so that this fund can be used to fill gaps in the provision of public toilets throughout the country, because it does seem to be, as a modus operandi, a practical scheme which works has been working in practice for a good few years now.
Thank you. Any other suggestions? Are we content to proceed on that basis? I mean, I think it might also be useful to write to Highland South Ayrshire and Aberdeenshire Council to understand how these comfort schemes operate. As I say, this was not something of which I was previously aware. And I'd be interested to know how many businesses are actually supportive of it, what effort had to be put into to achieving that, what the annual cost is, and how widely advertised and understood the scheme is, because it does seem to me to offer an opportunity which other councils might wish to take into account, and in addition may seek to use the fund Mr. Ewing is suggesting we write to the government about as a means of facilitating that. So we will carry this petition on at our convenience. To borrow. Thank you. Petition number 1956 to increase the provision of wheelchair accessible homes. Our next petition is petition 1956, lodged by Louise McGee. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the existing wheelchair accessible housing target guidance and to explore options for increasing the availability of wheelchair accessible housing in Scotland. Now, in the background information to this petition, Louise tells us she has been waiting for around 5 to 6 years to be offered a more suitable house, but the local authority has been unable to do so due to the lack of wheelchair-accessible houses in the area. In responding to the petition, the Scottish Government set out a range of actions being undertaken to increase the number of wheelchair-accessible houses across Scotland. This includes making funding available through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme and publishing guidance for local authorities on the setting of local housing strategy targets to support the delivery of wheelchair accessible housing across all tenures. The Scottish Government also state that they are taking forward reviews of the Housing Adaptation System and the Housing for Various Needs Design Guide, and has suggested that the petitioner may wish to contribute to public consultations which will take place as part of this work. I wonder, therefore, if members or colleagues have any suggestions that we might consider. Mr. Stewart.
I think the petitioner makes some very valid points here, and adaptations have been discussed in the past, and this Parliament and various committees have looked into the current situation and how it can be appraised. But I think it's important that we continue with this petition. So I would suggest, convener, that we write to COSLA and the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations to seek information on the progress being made to deliver more wheelchair-accessible homes across Scotland in particular, but also to find out from the Scottish Government and seek confirmation from them about issues raised by the petitioner, which include, in their view, the current housing adaptation system. And as I said, these systems have been looked at by the committees in the past as to how adaptations are being managed and the backlog and the difficulties about adaptations. So by seeking that from the Scottish Government, that would give us an update on the current situation. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. Are we content as a committee to proceed on that basis? We are. Thank you very much. So the committee the petition will stay open, and we will write as suggested by Mr. Stewart, and consider the petition again in due course. Petition number 1962, to stop motorhomes parking overnight out with formal campsites, caravan parks and Aries. Our next petition, this has been lodged by Lynn and Darren Redfern, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to improve licensing enforcement on motorhomes to ensure they are only parked in designated and regulated locations. Lynn and Darren explain that motorhomes place an unnecessary burden on local communities when they park out with the formal spaces through the disposal of rubbish, chemical toilets and dirty water. The Scottish Government have responded to the petition highlighting the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund, which has helped with the provision of facilities and addressing issues of irresponsible waste disposal. They also highlight newly revised Nature Scot guidance for land managers on off-road parking and positive awareness-raising work by the Visitor Management Group. The Scottish Government states that it believes the current response to increasing use of motorhomes is sufficient, pointing to feedback that camper vans have been managed better in 22 than in previous years. And they do not believe, therefore, that a formal requirement to use specific sites would address the challenges outlined in the petition. Do members or have any comments or suggestions for action on this particular petition? Mr. Sweeney.
I would just note that it's not just a rural problem, it's actually a persistent problem in parts of Glasgow as well. Having dealt with constituent correspondence on the matter in relation to parking of motorhomes in Glasgow Green, it might be an opportunity to look at what local authorities do in terms of enforcement of parking of motorhomes, whether there are local bylaws or provisions that might then be more widely adopted, because it does feel like it's a matter for local authority through bylaws and local levies on parking restrictions rather than it being something that should be a statutory measure.
Any other thoughts, Mr. Ewing?
Yes, I think the petitioner is probably not alone in suffering inconvenience from illegal parking of camper vans in places that are inappropriate. There's no doubt that that happens. I think that perhaps the Scottish Government response, though, is correct, and that I'm not sure that the particular prescription advocated would necessarily solve the problem. And it does occur to me also it's a matter of road traffic law and perhaps the criminal law in relation to illicit parking or local bylaws. I'm not quite sure whether you've considered that. I'm sorry, I don't know the answer to that. What I was going to say was a matter of practice, though, that the reference to heirs is by the petitioner is very helpful. And it is something which I discovered when I was tourism minister, that heirs exist as facilities for caravans and campervans and so on outside settlements and located with provision of services, water and sewage facilities and so on. So they are serviced sites and they are very prevalent in France. France has a network of heirs, apparently, and we really haven't got off the mark here. So I wondered, Convener, if we could perhaps, in an effort to solve the issue another way, to ask if the Scottish Government would consider promoting heirs. I know Visit Scotland are keen on this, for example, and as something which would qualify automatically under the Rural Infrastructure Fund, which again has made its presence in our deliberations today. So it's not quite what petitioner wants. I have some sympathy with petitioner because, particularly in the Highlands, it's a big problem, particularly in single-track roads which serve small communities, and parking in lay-bys illicitly as well is another problem, particularly in the NC500, I think, in the Highlands. But heirs, I think, would be the proper long-term solution, convener, so that everybody can be happy, holidaymakers can enjoy the countryside as they travel around in their campervan, if that's what they choose to do, and locals can avoid being inconvenienced by that third-party pleasure.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. I'm grateful for that exposition. That does seem like a commendable action that we might take in respect of the Scottish Government. In relation to Mr. Sweeney's suggestion, is there a way forward for us? Does that involve us writing to COSLA and seeking to see what enforcement actually takes place? I mean, I know that wearing a different hat in relation to show people that the approach by councils is highly individual and variable in the extreme. So I don't know that there will be a common response, but it might be interesting to try and find out what the position actually is in the way that these matters are currently approached and dealt with. So we will keep the petition open and we will move forward on those two streams and see what information comes further to us. And that brings us to the end of this morning's meeting. Thank you all very much. We'll be meeting again on the 7th of December.